Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Leo Durocher, Baseball's Prodigal Son, by Paul Dickson, narrated by Barry Abrams. Chapter 1. Pre-game. Leo Durocher, 1905 to 1991, was baseball's all-time leading character. Cocky, flamboyant, and galvanizing, casting a shadow across several baseball eras, from the time of Babe Ruth to the Space Age Astrodome, from Prohibition through the Vietnam War. For more than 40 years, he was a dominant figure in the game, with a Zelig-like ability to be present as a player or manager for some of the greatest teams and defining baseball moments of the 20th century. Unlike the passive Leonard Zelig, however, Durocher was an actor in all of it. He performed on three main stages, New York, Chicago, and Hollywood. He entered from the wings, strode to where the lights were brightest, and then took a poke at anyone who tried to upstage him. He shared the limelight on occasion, but only with Hollywood stars, such as Spencer Tracy, whom he called his lucky coin, movie tough guy and sometimes roommate George Raft, best friend Frank Sinatra, and his third wife, movie star Laraine Day. He had the right script. Durocher played shortstop for four major league teams, including two that were given nicknames that still resonate today, the 1928 Murderers Row New York Yankees and the 1934 Gas House Gang St. Louis Cardinals. Both of these great teams won the World Series with Durocher playing shortstop. He also appeared as a player on three National League All-Star teams, in 1936 as a Cardinal, and in 1938 and 1940 as a Brooklyn Dodger. Although he had a lackluster lifetime batting average of .247, teammate Babe Ruth nicknamed him the All-American Out because of his anemic offense, he earned a reputation as the best defensive shortstop of the era before World War II. Durocher went on to become manager of four major league teams for a total of 24 seasons. He managed 2,008 wins in 3,739 games, winning three National League pennants in 1941, 1951, and 1954, and the World Series in 1954. He was named Manager of the Year three times by the Sporting News. His lifetime winning percentage with the Dodgers, Giants, Cubs, and Astros was .540. At the time of his death, only five managers in Major League history had won more games than Durocher's 2008. Two of the teams he managed, the New York Giants and the Chicago Cubs, played in pennant races considered to be two of the most exciting of the 20th century. One was in 1951, when Durocher's Giants overcame a 13.5 game deficit, going 37-7 down the stretch to catch the runaway Brooklyn Dodgers and beat them in a playoff series that ended with Bobby Thompson's epic home run, the shot heard round the world. That final game, called the Miracle of Coogan's Bluff, is still regarded as among the greatest single games in baseball history. The other pennant race involved Durocher's 1969 Cubs, who had a 9-game lead in August, only to lose to the underdog New York Mets, who came out of the pack to win the pennant and ultimately the World Series. These two pennant drives are the only two in baseball history routinely described with the word miracle, and controversy followed Durocher after each of them. Did his elaborate system of sign-stealing and cheating contribute to the come-from-behind wins and Thompson's home run? Did the 1969 Cubs lose in part because Leo so demoralized his players, treating them unevenly down the stretch, deserting them during two key moments, creating turmoil in the clubhouse, and callously degrading them in defeat?
"Our offense went down the toilet, the defense went down the drain, and I'm still looking for a pitching staff," he said of his 1969 team after they lost the pennant. "I could have dressed nine broads as ballplayers, and they would have beaten the Cubs."
Durocher had a profound impact on managing, with disciples who are now among the handful of managers in the National Baseball Hall of Fame.
"When I was a coach, my number was 52, Tommy Lasorda said at the time of Durocher's death. "When I became manager, I wanted to carry Leo's number because of my respect and my admiration for him. He was an outstanding manager. In wearing his number, I hoped some of him would wear off on me. He was brilliant, by far one of the greats. He was a gambling, aggressive manager. He didn't worry about people second-guessing him. He had an electrifying personality with an ability to motivate men.
Durocher was also one of the most hated men in the game, a distinction he did little to shed and much to cultivate. Called baseball's problem child, he routinely attracted adjectives for aggressiveness: combative, fierce, fiery, feisty, bellicose, pugnacious, cheeky, contentious, truculent, and scrappy. He was one of the fiercest bench jockeys of all time. As a manager, he unapologetically used the brushback and beanball as weapons of intimidation, and his victims knew who to blame when they got drilled. In September 1953, when Durocher was managing the New York Giants, he told his pitcher to hit star outfielder Carl Furillo of the Brooklyn Dodgers. As Furillo made his way to first base after being hit, Durocher wagged his finger at him. Furillo charged the Giants' dugout, got Durocher in a headlock, and began choking him. In the melee, Furillo's hand was broken, and he was shelved for the rest of the season. At the time, Furillo led the National League in batting. Durocher could also intimidate his own players when it suited him. Ralph Cannon of the Chicago Herald-American wrote in 1947, "He could infuriate his men to superhuman effort out of sheer hatred of him personally." Ty Cobb hated Leo because he constantly baited him with insults. Leo also played the bully to Babe Ruth, whom he called dummy when they were Yankee teammates. Ruth accused Durocher of stealing his wristwatch. Years later, when Ruth's playing days were over, he was hired by the Brooklyn Dodgers as a first base coach. Durocher went out of his way to humiliate Ruth. The relationship ended in a fist fight that began when Durocher slapped Ruth in the face because of confusion over a signal. Manager Burley Grimes had to pull them apart. In December 1948, after Durocher became manager of the New York Giants, Dan Desmond, who wrote for the Hearst newspaper chain, began a series on Durocher that opened with, "No man in baseball history has been so consistent at provoking antagonisms, developing hatreds, and setting up situations of violence." There is no temporizing for him. Once he has started an argument, he fights down to the finish. For him, it's all out or nothing. Less than a year later, the legendary columnist Shirley Povich, writing in the Washington Post, called Durocher the most hated man in his profession. Yet, for all of the hatred he generated, he was a genius at turning it to his favor and making himself the center of attention. He thrived on bad press and the use of incivility as a means to getting his way. "No matter where you are," said one of his friends, an advertising executive named Corny Jackson, "you can stock a room with 20 people with better minds and better looks, and Leo will stand out like a neon light." As Harold Parrott, a former newsman and an official of the Brooklyn Dodgers during Durocher's years with the club, put it, "If he wanted to, he could walk into a room full of atomic scientists with some kind of information he had picked up in the men's room and hold them spellbound." Durocher hogged headlines for decades, and not just atop the sports pages. He was an icon of popular culture, appearing regularly in the gossip columns and being heard on radio comedies and then seen on popular television sitcoms of the black and white era. Durocher also garnered headlines for his 4 weddings and 4 divorces. 3 of his wives were strong women with their own careers who divorced him either because of his serial infidelities or his inability to give up gambling, or both. For all his on-field reputation as a hothead, his main offense against these women was indifference and inattention. Durocher's most famous ex-wife, Laraine Day, remarked about their post-divorce relationship, "There was no bitterness. We had just become interested in different things and different people. but we always stayed friends. Leo's public savagery, she said, was a self-created thing. She insisted that he was a nice guy, even if he lived by the motto, "Nice guys finish last," sliding into Bartlett's famous quotations on the strength of that line. Durocher gained notoriety for several odd tiffs and snits, such as when he sued actress Zsa Zsa Gabor and the advertising agency that hired her for a cool million because she invoked his name in a television commercial for the Amco chain of transmission shops. "Tell him Leo sent you," was the offending line, and it worked because there was only one Leo out there who mattered. Gabor and the advertising agency settled out of court, but in typical Durocher style, the matter was hashed out on Johnny Carson's Tonight Show, where both Leo and Zsa Zsa were regular guests. Durocher was a fan favorite, not because the fans liked him, but because they loved to bait him, even when he was winning. The writers knew this and gave him ink by the barrelful. They loved to watch him crash and burn and then rise from the ashes more arrogant and confident than ever. In New York, he dominated the sports pages from the time of Damon Runyon and Grantland Rice up to that of Pete Hamill and Jimmy Breslin. When Durocher died in 1991, the sports writer Dave Anderson wrote a piece about him in the New York Times entitled, "Leo the Lip Was Baseball in New York." And when he was finally elected to the National Baseball Hall of Fame in 1994, Steve Jacobson of Newsday wrote, "Durocher was one of the things the world disliked about New York." Durocher's appeal came in part because he chose to live and operate outside the lines, literally and figuratively outside the box. Unlike other managers, when his team was at bat, he ran the offense from the third base coach's box, but only after he had erased the chalked rectangle forming the box. Friend and baseball historian David Hubler, who grew up in the Bronx as a devoted Giants fan, recalls the ritual.
"The first thing we did was find Laraine Day in her special box, and then we waited for the Giants to bat and for Durocher to come running out of the dugout and use his spikes to kick away all the chalk lines on the third base. He always stayed in the box, but it had no lines."
Durocher's words, like baseball shoes, came with sharpened spikes.
"How you play the game is for college boys," he said. "When you're playing for money, winning is the only thing that matters."
When he was a manager, opposing batters moving close to the plate often heard him bellow to his pitcher,
"Stick it in his ear!"
He scoffed at the concept of good sportsmanship.
"Show me a good loser in professional sports, and I'll show you an idiot."
Or,
"If I was playing third base and my mother was rounding third with the run that was going to beat us, I'd trip her. Oh, I'd pick her up and brush her off and say, 'Sorry, Mom, but nobody beats me.'"
In his 1975 autobiography, Nice Guys Finish Last, Leo recalls how hurt his mother was when she heard this.
"She looked at me, and her eyes bugged out. 'Then you would have tripped me?' she screamed. 'You would have tripped me. You would. You would.' For the rest of my visit, she walked around with an injured air. And I guess she had a right to. God rest your soul, Mom. I'm afraid I would."
At his worst, Durocher was a cologne-soaked bully with a talent for creating bad situations. And, as Brooklyn Dodgers general manager Branch Rickey once said,
"then making them worse."
At his best, Durocher was a brilliant manager with a comic timing that allowed him to play straight man to a talking horse in a 1963 episode of the sitcom Mr. Ed. He also played a key role in baseball's racial integration, gaining acceptance for Jackie Robinson and nurturing a scared, slumping rookie named Willie Mays into becoming one of the game's all-time greatest players. For all of his shortcomings, Durocher was generous and generally kind when it came to his dealings with children and with bat boys, who occupied the lowest rung on the clubhouse ladder. Stan Strahl, who knew him on a regular basis at Ebbets Field, later said,
"He was aces in the clubhouse and always a big tipper."
Another bat boy who worked under him recalled him as somewhat distant from the clubhouse kids, but someone who would put the arm on the players to kick in for their expense money. As a manager, he integrated the New York Giants. Outfielder Monty Irvin and infielder Hank Thompson were called up late in the 1949 season and were welcomed by Durocher. Irvin remembered,
"Manager Leo Durocher called a team meeting and said, 'I want to introduce these two fellas. I think they can help us. Let me say this about race. I don't care if you're black, white, or green. If you can play baseball, you're welcome. That's all I'm going to say about it.' So he paved the way for us."
Willie Mays and Irvin always maintained their respect for Durocher, and Mays was the only baseball player to speak at his funeral. Other black players chimed in over time.
"In terms of kindness to younger players, the compassion he gave to black players," wrote Maury Wills, who had encountered him as a coach for the Los Angeles Dodgers, "Leo Durocher was surely one of the nice guys."
Durocher himself would claim that his umpire baiting was just an act, carefully choreographed for the fans in the stands and the television cameras.
"Sometimes I would be shaking my fist at umpire Babe Pinelli when actually we would be screaming about where we were going for dinner."
Pinelli was known for occasionally turning a Durocher tirade into a smile. On one occasion in Brooklyn, Durocher charged onto the field to furiously question one of Pinelli's calls that Leo knew was good. As he talked, he caught a whiff of the lotion Leo used liberally after shaving and leaned closer.
"Leo," he said, "that stuff you use sure smells wonderful. What is it?"
According to Pinelli,
Leo looked pained for a second, then broke into a grin and walked away.
Durocher was posthumously voted into the National Baseball Hall of Fame in 1994 as a manager, despite some opposition. For years after his death, his friends and those who wrote about him were still trying to put him into context. Broadcaster Lindsey Nelson, who worked with Durocher as a broadcaster for NBC, said in his autobiography, Hello Everybody, that Durocher would be the manager he would choose if he had to win only one game.
He might steal it or whatever, but somehow he would figure out how to win it.
This book is a biography of an American original set in sports rather than a sports biography. It draws heavily on time and place, exploring the rough-and-tumble world of New York baseball before, during, and after World War II, Rat Pack Hollywood, the radicalized Chicago of the Vietnam era and the 1968 Democratic Convention, and finally Houston, still basking in the light of the Apollo moon landing. At the heart of Durocher's story is the conflict between reality and stagecraft, drama and dramatics. And this provides a way of looking at who he really was. One of the difficulties of writing about Durocher is the fact that he periodically reinvented elements of his past to give them greater drama and give himself a more confrontational or heroic presence. It was as if he were a playwright, constantly revamping the early acts of a play to make the work all the more melodramatic. A case in point is Durocher's alternative childhood, a childhood he manufactured over the years and portrayed in Nice Guys Finish Last, which is loaded with exaggeration and falsehood. His faux childhood was not without charm.
"There was no organized activity for kids," he wrote with the aid of collaborator Ed Lynn. "We were on our own, and we did everything. Crazy things. As soon as the Connecticut River would freeze over, 8 or 10 of us would put on our racing skates and skate all the way to Boston, 100 miles back and forth. We'd start out early in the morning, and when we'd get to the Harvard Rowing Club, we'd just turn around and come back."
Durocher had, in the words of the Springfield Journal, contrived to make the Connecticut River run east to west rather than north to south. There was no way on earth, the Journal explained, that one could ice skate between Springfield and Boston and end up on the Charles River in Cambridge. The Charles runs south to north in eastern Massachusetts.
There are few personalities in baseball history about which more has been written and less truly known than that of Leo Ernest Durocher. wrote author David Clairbaud in 2000 in his book Durocher's Cubs, The Greatest Team That Didn't Win. Most of the writing about Leo is far more descriptive than analytical, driven by either the writer's admiration or more likely contempt for him, rather than by an effort to understand. Was he a nasty man, or merely someone who sought celebrity by playing the bad guy? Was his gambling a debilitating addiction, or was it simply part of the rough-and-tumble image that he created for himself? What kind of man would brag about winning money in a fixed horse race with a tip from a syndicate criminal named Sleepout Louis Levinson, as Durocher did, and not expect to raise other red flags and suspicions? Even those who knew him for many years couldn't decide. The late Bob Bregg of the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, one of the most easygoing, likable sports writers ever to peck at a typewriter, wrote the day following Leo's death, "Losing Leo Durocher is like losing, take your choice, an old friend or enemy." Chapter 2. Enfant Terrible. Leo Durocher was born at home in West Springfield, Massachusetts, on July 27, 1905, the youngest of four sons of a French-Canadian couple, George J. and Clara M. Durocher. A religious woman, Clara was pleased that Leo had arrived on the day after St. Anne Day, as St. Anne is patron saint of women in labor. Until 2 weeks before Leo's birth, Clara had been stitching baseballs at home for A.G. Spaulding and Brothers, the sporting goods manufacturer located in nearby Chicopee. She worked on a piecework basis, paid for each baseball that she finished and returned to the factory. So it was with a real sense of irony that she heard the attending physician say, "Look at those hands. He's not a baby. He's more like a baseball player." The story sounds apocryphal, and may be just that, but it was what Clara Durocher told interviewers when asked about the birth of her youngest son as he rose to fame. George and Clara Durocher left Montreal when they were quite young and moved first to Cohoes, New York, and then to an apartment in a triple-decker building at 10 School Street in West Springfield, Massachusetts, a stone's throw from the Connecticut River, which ran south past their home from Quebec to the Long Island Sound. The dream of the Durochers was to someday return to Quebec, so Leo and his brothers grew up in an atmosphere of impermanence as their mother strove to keep French culture and language alive, anticipating a day when they would need it back home. Clara's devotion to the church and to Quebec would continue for many years. In 1951, Arthur Mann, a writer who had gotten to know Clara in his role as Durocher's Boswell, learned that part of the allowance she received from Leo, and unknown to him at the time, was used to keep a candle lit at St. Anne de Beaupré in Quebec for her beloved son. Durocher's father was employed intermittently by the Boston and Albany Railroad, and the family eked out a living. Durocher's mother took in boarders and cleaned other people's houses. In the parlance of the time, she was called a scrub woman. His older brothers, in order of their ages, were Clarence, Raymond, and Armand. Leo's religious instruction was given in French at the St. Louis Catholic Church, but by age 7, he was unable to master the catechism in French, so he was barred from the classes that would lead to Holy Communion at the St. Louis Church. "That's all right," he told the priest. "I can go to Father O'Donnell's church. They have the same God down there." Leo quickly became a boy of the streets and sandlots, interacting with other boys who mostly spoke English. He also attended Main Street and Park Avenue grammar schools in West Springfield, where English was spoken. Leo always had a baseball glove with him wherever he went, even on the days he went to school, as he was given to truancy. Young Leo loved baseball and got to play on the baseball team of the Immaculate Conception Church of the Catholic Junior League. He played pickup ball around the neighborhood, as well as with any team looking for a nimble infielder. Durocher also played basketball and football, and to each sport he brought a determined desire to win. He learned early that winning meant everything, and he had the gift of speed, agility, and extraordinary eye-hand coordination. Growing to 5'10", He was the tallest of the Durocher brothers and best suited for athletics. He stopped attending school regularly when he was around age 12. He worked at a local pool hall and became a consummate pool player and local pool hall hustler. One of his early jobs was as an office boy at Gilbert and Barker, manufacturers of pumps and oil burners. His restless nature didn't allow him to stay there for long. Incidentally, his oldest brother Clarence eventually became the firm's chief accountant. Little else is known about Leo's younger years. Those few writers who got close to him in the decades ahead found that he refused to discuss this period of his life. Reporter Tom Meaney, who spent several months traveling and living with Durocher over the winter of 1944-45 while Leo was entertaining troops overseas, wrote that during this period, Durocher never spoke of his family or his boyhood. On at least two occasions over in Italy, I was with Leo when he ran across men who had known him in his youth, which apparently was as normal as that of the average American of modest means in a town the size of West Springfield. Harold Flavin, a local historian and reference librarian who wrote about Durocher for the Springfield Journal, noted that everyone who knew Leo Durocher, or knew of him when he lived in West Springfield, had at least one favorite story to tell about him. Flavin said that his own father never tired of telling about Leo getting caught switching dice in a big crap game and being chased all the way across the North End Bridge. Flavin added that Leo's agility, both mental and physical, as usual, stood him in good stead. Durocher had a second, false childhood, which he fabricated as he became famous and more notorious. The bogus claims were added one at a time, but the primary source of this misinformation is Nice Guys Finish Last, which is awash in things that are totally exaggerated or demonstrably false. Leo did such a good job hoodwinking his readers that there are constant retellings of these tales today, not only online, but in footnoted books on baseball history. In his book, Durocher claimed he was born in 1906 and that his father was an engineer for the Boston and Albany Railroad before he had a heart attack. As Flavin pointed out in his article in the Springfield Journal, Leo was born in 1905. His father had a drinking problem, and when he worked, if at all, he had a lowlier job than engineer with the B&A. Leo claimed to have idolized Springfield neighbor Walter Rabbit Moranville, the first future Hall of Famer to enter his life, and to have watched Moranville play in the 1914 World Series in Boston. By his own account at the time, Leo had never seen a major league game until he was a member of the 1925 Yankee squad at the tail end of the season. According to the fabricated Durocher, created for Nice Guys Finish Last, his formal education ended when he was suspended for getting into a fight with a high school math teacher, and he never went back. The teacher, according to this fable long repeated in print, slapped Durocher, and Durocher hit the teacher in the back with a long-hooked pole used to open and close windows. Durocher also claimed in Nice Guys Finish Last that he forfeited a college scholarship to Holy Cross because of the violent incident with the high school teacher. In an earlier version of the Holy Cross story, he said that he was offered a baseball scholarship to the college, but turned it down to pursue a professional career. Harold Flavin found no evidence in local school records that Durocher had ever attended a single day of high school. Durocher was alternatively telling interviewers from his earliest days in the majors that he was a high school graduate, or that he had never gone to high school. Although Leo presented himself as the Durocher kid who got into trouble, the reality was that his brother Armand was the one whose transgressions made the newspapers. In July 1922, he was shot in the back while in a car with four companions in an incident that police suspected was part of a bootlegger's war. Later that year, Armand was found guilty of disturbing the peace and vagrancy and given a suspended sentence at a state prison farm. Leo fast became a star in the youth baseball leagues and sandlots of West Springfield. At age 14, he was recruited to play shortstop on the semi-pro team of the Merrick Athletic Association. He also played football for the Merricks and was the team's star halfback and its outstanding kicker. While playing for Merrick, He also played baseball for semi-pro teams outside the league, as far afield as Turner's Falls and Miller's Falls, which were both about 40 miles from Springfield. In 1921, at age 16, Durocher went to work for Weico Electric of West Springfield in a factory that manufactured batteries for motorcycles and magnetos for small stationary engines. Many of the motorcycle batteries were installed in new Indian motorcycles rolling off an assembly line in a large brick factory in downtown Springfield. Weico fielded a first-rate Industrial League baseball team, for which Leo played as a quid pro quo for his job with the company. While working at Weico, Leo became a fan of the Hamptons, a short-lived Eastern League team that played regularly in Springfield at League Park. When Leo asked for an opportunity to play for the Hamptons, he was told he was not even good enough to merit a tryout. According to later accounts, at this point, the teenage boy began boasting, "Someday, I will be paid for playing baseball, and you will pay to see me play." In March 1922, Durocher was fined $50 on two charges of illegally operating a jitney bus. Time has obscured the nature of this crime and the reason it carried such a hefty fine, but he was likely operating an unlicensed taxicab or omnibus in a jurisdiction where licenses were a major source of revenue. This is the only record of his running afoul of the law recorded in the Springfield Republican. For the better part of the next 2 years, Leo kept his job at Weico, where he worked alongside a black man named David Red, who was a welder at the factory. Born in Georgetown, Georgia, Red had likely come north to make a better living for himself and his family. Red genuinely liked Durocher and argued that Leo was wasting his time in the factory and that it was time for him to go out and make some of that good money in baseball. In early 1925, Harry Nunn, a railroad foreman who coached boys' baseball teams, took an interest in Leo and arranged to get him a tryout with the Eastern League Hartford Senators, then a top-rung A-level team. Through Nunn, Leo came to the attention of Jack O'Hara, an independent scout who wanted Leo to leave his job and come to Hartford, then managed by Patty O'Connor, who would help the New York Yankees develop their star first baseman Lou Gehrig. But Leo had uncharacteristically lost his confidence. He told Red that it was a fast league and that two of the best ballplayers he had ever seen, brothers Bunny and Eddie Trauschke, had been unable to make it in the Eastern League. Leo was happy at Weico and did not want to lose his job, which paid $58.50 a week, a princely sum for a young man in those days. With renewed vigor, David Red convinced him to go to Hartford for a tryout.
"I told him not to worry about getting a leave," Red recalled to a reporter from Sports Illustrated in 1955. "You can always get a job. You're a brilliant young fella, and you're a better ball player than all the others around here. You're different."
Leo then went to his bosses, who granted him a 2-week unpaid leave of absence. In Hartford, as the Senators prepared for the season ahead, he employed his customary hustle, but it was not enough. And on the morning of April 15th, Leo and 11 other hopefuls were informed that they had not made the second cut. The Hartford Courant noted,
"Some of these fellows showed good form and might turn out well if there was enough time to work with and redevelop their faults."
On the following Monday, April 20th, Leo arrived at the Weico plant gate planning to go back to work and was met by Jack O'Hara, who told him that a spot had opened for him on the Hartford team and that he had with him a contract and the car fare Durocher needed to get back to Hartford, and that he would travel with the team to Bridgeport for opening day on April 23rd. According to the Hartford Courant, the actual reason Durocher got his second chance was that O'Connor suddenly gave up on a temperamental and talented infielder with the surname Rose because of his negative attitude. He called on Durocher, whom he then penciled in as his starting shortstop. In Bridgeport, the Hartford Senators won their first game of the 1925 season by a score of 2-1. In his first professional game, Durocher, batting eighth, had one hit in four at-bats, scored a run, and had four putouts and two assists, garnering some nice press in the next morning's newspapers. The Bridgeport Post credited Durocher with life-saving play. The Bridgeport Times, which referred to him as Durocher, cited his two-out single to right field. And the Hartford Courant not only reported that he performed like a veteran, but gave him his first headline, which read in part, "Durocher's hit with two out starts successful rally." The Hartford Times said Leo had played a sensational game. In the next game, Leo had two hits, an error, and his first double play. The next day, he was part of two double plays, and the day after that, against the Albany Senators, he got his first triple, along with a note in the Courant that he had a great and accurate arm. Leo was on his way. On May 20th, Hartford played the Springfield Ponies in Springfield in a game that was designated as Durocher's Day, and he was presented with a gold watch from his former shopmates from the Wyco factory. He then appropriated much of the limelight through spectacular infield play in a game lost by Hartford. Durocher seemed to outdo himself when Hartford played Springfield. His first home run came on June 19th in Springfield, where it was reported that he was egged on by his old friends from West Springfield. Like all leagues, the eight teams of the 1925 Eastern League looked for players who could bring the less-than-rabid fan to the ballpark and increase the team's income. In 1924, it had been Lou Gehrig, and increasingly in 1925, it was Leo Durocher who got fans to board a trolley car and head to the ballpark. The Hartford Courant described Durocher as a find, a player who had risen from obscurity to fame in a matter of weeks and could draw people to the ballpark. Soon, he was being scouted by major league clubs. The first wave came at the end of June from Brooklyn, Pittsburgh, and Cincinnati, and was followed by Jack Doyle scouting for the Chicago Cubs. Doyle followed Durocher for several weeks and witnessed some sensational work in the field, beginning with a July 12th triple play that began as Leo fielded a low-line drive. On July 17th in Pittsfield, with the bases loaded, a Pittsfield batter hit a low-line drive that looked like it would be good for two runs. Durocher dove to his right and barehanded the sharply hit ball. The runners held as Durocher doubled over in agony, and the game had to be held up so he could recover. Hartford won the game, and the headline in the next morning's Springfield Republican was the stuff of dreams for a young player. Durocher's great catch halts Pittsfield's attack. West Springfield boy saves game for Hartford by making sensational nab with bases loaded. Hartford wins 8-5. The Hartford Courant described Durocher's catch as sensational, brilliant, and one of the best we have seen here all season. Doyle was not the only scout following Durocher from game to game. Paul Critchell of the New York Yankees, who was regarded as a top judge of talent and had previously scouted and signed Lou Gehrig while he was still a student at Columbia University, also had an eye on him. In another season, Durocher might not have even gotten a second glance from the Yankees, but 1925 was different. Expected to win the pennant and reclaim their 1923 World Series championship, they were mired in the second division on their way to a seventh-place finish. One problem was Babe Ruth's ailing stomach and relatively poor season. The other major problem was the infield. On the eve of the season, James Harrison of the New York Times wrote that veteran shortstop Everett Scott was a great weakness. Scott had shown signs of age during the 1924 season. However, there was confidence that rookie shortstop Pee Wee Wanninger, who one Yankee scout called the best young fielding shortstop since Moranville, could take over if Scott continued to struggle in the field. But while most were high on Wanninger, Yankee manager Miller Huggins was not. During the Yankees' first visit to St. Louis, Huggins left the team and traveled to St. Paul to scout Mark Koenig of the St. Paul Saints. Huggins made no bones about his dilemma.
"It has been a shame the way balls have traveled through our infield," Huggins said in reference to his struggling middle infield. With this need in mind, the Yankee scouts hit the trail in hopes of finding the best young shortstops in the field. No big league teams had direct affiliations with minor league teams then. Rather,
They looked upon them as an open pool of talent. The top-rated shortstop in the minor leagues was Buddy Meyer of the New Orleans Pelicans. However, Washington Senators super scout Joe Engel beat the Yankees to the punch by arranging for the purchase of Meyer. Aware of Meyer's reputation, the Yankees offered to pay $50,000 to Washington and $50,000 to New Orleans for him. Senators owner Clark Griffith balked at the offer. With Meyer gone, Critchell got Yankees chief executive Ed Barrow on the telephone.
"Durocher?" Barrow barked into the phone. "He's hardly hitting his weight."
Critchell was adamant.
"He'll be great. He's got moxie."
Barrow relented. On July 20th, Doyle made an offer of $10,000 to the Hartford Senators, but this was almost immediately topped by Critchell, who announced that he had purchased Durocher for a down payment of $5,000 and $7,000 to be paid later. Under the terms of the deal, Durocher was to stay in Hartford until the end of the minor league season and then report to the Yankees. He reported on September 20th, 1925. An article in his hometown Springfield Republican lauded Leo for the jump from the obscurity of the Sandlots to signing with a major league club in half a season, but he was quick to point out there were better shortstops in the Eastern League and named several of them. Durocher was picked not because he was the best, but because he showed the most promise. Like everything that the Yankees did in those days, the sale of Durocher made national news, and with it, the kind of hyperbole that could only infuriate those minor leaguers, especially veterans, who felt they deserved the nod before Durocher. The Los Angeles Times reported that he led the list in both fielding and hitting and proclaimed, "He is fast and veteran players enthuse over his form, both afield and at bat." The same day, the Hartford Courant observed that Durocher had problems at the plate stemming from his proclivity to put his front foot in the bucket, which then, as now, alluded to a fearful batter who steps away from home plate with his leading foot in order to avoid getting hit by the ball. Sports writer Bill Lee, who came to the Courant the same year Durocher broke into the Eastern League, later wrote that Durocher behaved so timidly that bench jockeys of rival clubs rode him unmercifully. Lee called Leo a Mr. Milquetoast, alluding to a comic strip character of the time also known as the Timid Soul, alleging that players in the Eastern League said he didn't have the courage to dig in when rival pitchers were throwing close to keep him loosened up. Lee added,
"They threw other accusations at Durocher, too, and some of these continued to be directed at him when he progressed to the majors by way of the Yankees."
Hartford manager Patty O'Connor was reported to have caught him red-handed with marked bills. Reports of missing money from other ballplayers pointed toward Durocher. O'Connor held back the irate players from pounding Durocher by promising to get rid of him once the pennant race was over. Hartford won, and O'Connor kept his word by packing Durocher off to the Yankees. Durocher was warmly received by the Hartford fans in his first game after signing with the Yankees, but one reporter noted in his game notes that the signing had not improved Durocher's ability as a batsman, he went 0-for-4 at the plate that day, but had, it seemed, given him added dash as an infielder. Despite his lackluster plate appearances, writers who had never seen him somehow got the impression that he was much better than he really was. On August 7th, the Boston Globe called him a formidable hitter, even though he was below average for the league. However, he had a propensity for timely hits, such as at a game he won on July 23rd with a bases-loaded game-winning single. His average on August 10th was .226. In mid-August, the Yankees spent $75,000 acquiring another shortstop, Tony Lazzeri, from Salt Lake. The morning after the sale, the Springfield Republican ran a large photograph of Lazzeri under the banner, "Rival for Leo Durocher with Yanks next season." The Yankees owner, Jacob Rupert, had vowed to buy the players he needed to become a pennant winner, or, in his words, to rebuild at any cost. During the course of the summer, he spent more than $350,000 on new players, including Mark Koenig, still another shortstop whom he had purchased from St. Paul for $60,000. One thing that Lazzeri, Koenig, and Durocher had in common was that all three had been scouted and signed by Paul Critchell. If Durocher had one bright, shining moment with Hartford, it came on August 11th against Casey Stengel's Worcester Panthers, in which he won the game with a slashing single. Paddy O'Connor was deliriously happy over the win, and in his glee, thumped and smashed Leo around, as did everyone else who could lay their hands on the youngster. He was then carried off the field on the shoulders of what the Current termed a maniacal horde. The goat of the 4-3 victory was player-manager Casey Stengel, who yanked a pitcher who was winning for a man who quickly loaded the bases. Stengel and Durocher were early and easy adversaries. One day, when the two teams met, Stengel got to the ballpark early, and while the Senators were holding a meeting, Stengel went out to the shortstop position and scratched Durocher's batting average, 208 at the time, in the dirt in letters 6 feet tall.
"And you ought to have seen his face when he came out and saw that," Stengel recalled later in his own memoir. "Of course, he knew then that I was a big smart aleck, the same as himself."
The abuse heaped on Durocher increased as the season wore on. It came to a climax in a torrid series between the Senators and the Waterbury Brascos at the end of the season to determine the championship. The Brascos were riding the Senators hard, but worked on Durocher in particular. They taunted him about his inability to stand up under fire and mocked him while he was in the batter's box. The Brascos secured the Eastern League championship after beating the Senators in a doubleheader on September 18th. The final game of the season was in Bridgeport, and therefore meaningless. Durocher arrived at the ballpark that afternoon without his uniform, and O'Connor was forced to replace him, thus allowing Durocher to depart Hartford with an act of bravado, as attested to by his last headline as a Senator: "Durocher arrives without uniform." But Durocher had acquitted himself well during the season. Casey Stengel learned that Leo was a formidable force on defense.
"We might have even won the pennant that year if he hadn't thrown some of my men out at home on relays, and with me coaching at third and sending them in myself."
Durocher's name would soon appear in Spalding's official baseball guide, along with his final statistics in the Eastern League for 1925. He appeared in 151 games with 536 at-bats and 118 hits for a batting average of .220 in the lower third of the league. His fielding percentage was .933, and he led the league with 59 errors. 2 days later, on September 22nd, Durocher left for New York to don the pinstriped Yankee uniform. The Yankees were 64-81, on their way to a seventh-place finish. Durocher's first game in the majors came on October 2nd, 1925, when, in the next-to-last game of the season, he pinch-hit for Garland Braxton in the eighth inning of a game the Yankees were losing to the Philadelphia Athletics. Durocher flied out, and the Yankees ended up losing the game 10-0. Durocher also got into the final game of the season for less than an inning with no at-bats. Durocher's inauspicious debut was captured by the great baseball photographer Charles M. Conlon, whose portraits of Leo as a 1925 Yankee suggest a quiet, shy young man seated at the end of the bench. In January, Durocher's contract was sold to the A-level Atlanta Crackers of the Southern Association for the 1926 season. Early letters home were shared and paraphrased in the local newspaper. He said he was feeling great and that there was a fine group of boys on the club. In exhibition play, he hit leadoff, but in late April, he was yanked for his weakness at the plate and replaced by Grant Gilbert, also under contract to the Yankees. Gilbert was no equal to Durocher in the field, having committed 3 errors in his first game as shortstop for the Crackers. Gilbert was moved to third, and Durocher put back at shortstop a few days later, leading the Crackers to an 8-7 victory over the Mobile Bears with 2 hits, a single and a double, and what the Atlanta Constitution termed his sensational fielding. On May 9th, in 3 times at bat, he had a triple, a single, and a sacrifice fly. In a game on May 12th,
he had a home run and a triple on which he scored on a wild throw. Leo got into a jam on August 4th that landed him in police court. Crackers pitcher Hollis McLaughlin was being heckled by a man in the stands while he pitched during the first inning. When McLaughlin headed for the dugout, the man continued his heckling, and McLaughlin headed into the stands, where he punched the man repeatedly in the face and body. Durocher charged into the stands behind McLaughlin to give aid to his pitcher and took a couple extra swings at the man before police broke up the attack.
"A general riot was averted," wrote Dick Hawkins,
the sports editor of the Atlanta Constitution, the next day,
"and peace was restored, with everything much as before, except the face of the fan, which, alas, may never be the same again."
In court, Leo was fined $11 for assault and battery, and McLaughlin did not appear in court, thereby forfeiting his bond. The man who had been beaten was a streetcar conductor named W.L. Lawrence, who had come to the game with his young grandson and some friends and claimed he had been attacked for simply exercising the fans' right to rag a player. Lawrence sued the Atlanta Baseball Company, which owned the Crackers, for $20,000 in damages, but lost when the court determined that McLaughlin was acting on his own and not as an employee of the team. The precedent set by this case was clear. If a fan was beaten or otherwise abused by an employee of a baseball team, the only way to recover damages was to sue the employee. Whether or not Leo understood this at the time, it would prove relevant to him in the years to come. Later in the season, after McLaughlin had been traded to the Birmingham team, he was jailed for getting into a fierce battle with a batter, which had to be broken up by the police. Durocher's abilities as a shortstop seemed, if anything, to improve as the season went on. In the same afternoon that Leo was involved in the attack on the fan, the Crackers played a doubleheader with the Memphis Chicks, in which he piled up 16 assists without an error and figured in two double plays. Hawkins of the Constitution suggested that a bit of lightning hung suspended from Durocher's right shoulder. Earlier in the season, Hawkins had given Durocher the nickname Leapin' Leo because of his extraordinary ability to leave the ground to make a play. In all, he played in 130 games and batted .238, but his eyes were always fixed on the Yankees, and he watched them stagger to the pennant and then lose to the Cardinals in the 1926 World Series. Durocher later claimed that he sat on the Yankee bench during this World Series and got to watch as old Grover Cleveland Alexander came shuffling in from the bullpen to strike out Tony Lazzeri with the bases loaded. He was particularly interested in the record of shortstop Mark Koenig, whom he hoped to replace. According to one report, he vowed that if he could get up to the big club, he would make Koenig look like an armless monkey. Returning home at the end of the 1926 season, Durocher once more received a slip of paper from the Yankee front office informing him that his contract had been sold to the St. Paul Club of the American Association. However frustrating, it was a step up in leagues to AA. Leo spent the winter in West Springfield, living with his parents. He played on a local semi-pro basketball team known as the Westsiders. Basketball was enormously popular in western Massachusetts at the time, in part because it was invented at Springfield College and was regarded as the indigenous sport. Durocher lacked height, but more than made up for it as a ball handler. Leo left home for the St. Paul team's spring training camp in Texas on March 5, 1927, and the Republican soon carried stories to the effect that he was electrifying the fans of the Lone Star State with his sensational fielding. In one game, he made four consecutive banner plays, one report stated, but at bat, he was still classified as fair. Durocher's manager at St. Paul was one Artemus Ward Nick Allen, who had played for the Cubs and the Reds and was now making a name for himself as a minor league skipper. Known as Roarin' Nick because of his umpire baiting on the field, Allen was directly responsible for turning Durocher from a tongue-tied youth into a first-rate bench jockey who excelled at riding the players on the opposing club. Allen's confrontations with umpires were epic. On one occasion, five policemen were needed to complete an ejection.
Later in his career, he admitted to being an umpire baiter and a wild bull, but the antics were just for show to increase attendance. Under Allen, the St. Paul Saints were the most aggressive club in all of professional baseball, and Durocher fit in nicely, especially when it came to unsettling the other players. Casey Stengel's Toledo Mudhens were in St. Paul on Sunday, May 8th, about the same time Durocher got his new voice. During the game, Durocher rode a rookie named Joe Kelly mercilessly. Finally, Kelly challenged Durocher. Expecting a roundhouse right, Durocher was unprepared for a solid and powerful left. According to a later account in the Toledo Blade, Durocher went down as if he had been dropped from the clouds, with his face badly disfigured and his front teeth down his throat. Then Allen rushed into the fray and Kelly decked him as well, again with a left hook. Back in Massachusetts, the Springfield Republican reported on the slugfest. Reports from St. Paul state that Durocher is innocent of any blame in the rumpus. The Blade later claimed that for years to come, the Mudhens got an annual bill from the St. Paul Club for $75 for Durocher's bridge work. It was never paid. Perhaps because of the Kelly fight, Leo got a reputation of being all lip and no fist. Pitchers started throwing at Leo's head to provoke him, and Leo learned how to get out of the way.
"I became an expert beanball dodger," he later told Arthur Mann. "All it ever got them was little Leo on first base. Those beanballs helped me get 52 trips to the bags."
After sweeping the Browns in St. Louis in August, the Yankees planned to board a special train for St. Paul to play an exhibition game against the Saints. Just before they left St. Louis, manager Huggins and St. Paul president Bob Connery shared a taxi with Arthur Mann, who was traveling with the team for the New York World. As soon as the cab started, Connery spoke.
"Say, Hug, there's a shortstop on my team I want you to take a good look at tomorrow," he said. "He's really something in the field. Be sure and look him over."
"Okay," Huggins agreed.
"What's his name?"
"Durocher," Connery said. "Leo Durocher. He might help you."
Mann was taken aback by what he considered to be an unwarranted display of presumptuousness at his expense. Durocher was ostensibly Yankee property, earmarked from the time he first played at Hartford and most certainly scrutinized during his year in Atlanta. So Mann said,
"I don't know what you guys are trying to do for me, but you're wasting your breath. Hug must know all about Durocher. Besides, he had the kid at Yankee Stadium for a short look late last September and the year before. Why do you pretend he's something new?"
There was no answer, Mann later recalled. Indeed, there was no further conversation during the remainder of the cab ride to the Grand Avenue station. All of this was a puzzlement to Mann, but he later came to realize that it was part of a Huggins plan to shoehorn Durocher into an invincible Yankee team that was shaping up as the greatest ever seen in baseball, one whose lineup would soon be called Murderer's Row. Both on paper and in reality, it was formidable. However, according to Arthur Mann, what the public didn't know was that Huggins felt Mark Koenig was not the fielder and playmaker he needed, and that the great Tony Lazzeri was epileptic, and though an attack had never happened on the field, he was subject to seizures. "Being a young and supposedly green baseball writer," Mann later concluded, "I was counted on to assume from this phony conversation that Huggins had discovered the phenom in a St. Paul exhibition game, and undoubtedly printed when the story of the actual player transfer broke. It is possible that the prime reason for the overnight St. Paul trip, made on a special train and augmented by the finest and largest meal ever served, was to show off Durocher to the itinerant New York riders." The Mudhens, under Stengel, won the American Association pennant, and Durocher left St. Paul at the end of the 1927 season with a metaphoric lip, a real set of dentures, a chip on his shoulder, and a genuine sparring partner in Stengel. By dint of a cab ride in St. Louis, he had piqued the initial curiosity of eventual friend and chronicler Arthur Mann. He had a new appreciation for umpire bashing as crowd-pleasing, attendance-building theatrics. He set an American Association record for 213 double plays, played in 171 games, batted a respectable 253, and hit 7 home runs. The 1927 Yankees ended the season with a record of 110-44, finishing 19 games in front of the Philadelphia Athletics and sweeping the Pittsburgh Pirates in the World Series. That winter, the Yankees bought Durocher's contract from St. Paul for an undisclosed sum, although it was known to be in the range of $50,000. While he was being brought up to plug the hidden weaknesses in the middle of the Yankee infield, Huggins also believed that a pepper pot like Durocher was an asset. During the winter of 1927-28, Durocher was determined to improve his hitting and make sure he was well-positioned with the Yankees. Back home in West Springfield, he suspended a sandbag from the ceiling in the basement of his parents' house that he whacked away at with a bat every day. This, he said, would allow him to practice as a left-handed batter, which he felt gave him a better cut at the ball. Durocher now felt he was ready for the Yankees. He now had his own creation story, which was that his father had advised him that the best way to get along in professional baseball was to keep his mouth shut. He had followed this advice at first, but this went against Nick Allen, who had told him to show him you're alive, talk it up, and make some noise. This is baseball, not a church. Chapter 3. Damned Yankee. On Friday, February 24, 1928, Leo Durocher arrived at Pennsylvania Station in Manhattan and boarded the Orange Blossom Special, the luxurious passenger train, southbound for St. Petersburg, Florida. His companions included four other New York Yankees, including Lou Gehrig and Babe Ruth, who would be vying for new home run records in the coming season. The Yankees' Loyal Rooters Band played Auld Lang Syne as young fans darted up and down the station platform, peering in every window, attempting to get a peek at Ruth, who kept out of sight. That night, the train stopped at a whistle stop in Georgia to pick up others headed for Yankee spring training, including sports writer Tom Meaney of the New York Telegram, who upon boarding and hearing Ruth's booming voice coming from the next car, headed to Ruth and found him in a poker game with Eddie Bennett, the good luck mascot of the team, Pee Wee Doherty, the clubhouse attendant, and a dapper rookie Meaney had never laid eyes on before.
"And what's your name again, kid?" asked Ruth as he introduced the rookie.
"Durocher," he replied. "Leo Durocher." Meaney later recalled it was somehow prophetic that he would first glimpse Durocher in a poker game. Here he was, bound for his first major league training camp, sitting in at a card game with the greatest figure baseball had ever known, as cool, as at home, as though he had been a Yankee all his life. Meaney and writer Gary Schumacher of the New York Evening Journal, who boarded at the same stop, were dealt into the game, and before the first hand had been played, Leo had begun calling the writers by their first names, instructing them on when to bid and when to deal, and announcing who had raised. Meaney observed that Durocher had already taken charge. The Yankees trained at Crescent Lake Park in St. Petersburg, and from the first day of exhibition play, Durocher put on a dazzling defensive display at shortstop. The St. Petersburg Times reported that manager Miller Huggins and a few writers were looking on when Durocher charged forward for a slow grounder, stabbed the ball on the run, and whipped it to Lou Gehrig at first.
Huggins cracked a slight smile as his eyes softened, like a proud father watching his son.
Huggins was immediately taken with Durocher's ability as an infielder and quickly declared that Durocher had made the roster as his substitute middle infielder, backing up Koenig at shortstop and Lazeri at second base. Koenig and Lazeri were both from San Francisco, had come up together, and had formed a close relationship off the field. Durocher posed a threat to both men. On the offensive side, his new teammates were less impressed with the rookie they called Frenchie. Babe Ruth advised him he could bat 400 by becoming a switch hitter. By doing that, he could bat 200 right-handed and 200 left-handed. As if to prove Ruth wrong, On the team's way north for opening day in Philadelphia, the Yankees stopped in Knoxville for a game against Gabby Street's Tennessee Smokies of the Sally League. Durocher played shortstop for Koenig, who was nursing an injured heel. The Yankees won 14-4. Durocher homered, and Ruth did not, although the Babe did register a triple, double, a single, and two walks. When the Yankees arrived at Scheib Park in Philadelphia to open the season against Connie Mack's Athletics on April 11th, the temperature was 45 degrees, and heavy wind blew newspapers and trash from nearby alleys around the stadium during the opening ceremonies. The moan of the wind was so loud that it drowned out the sound of the trombone duet, which Westbrook Pegler, covering the game for the Chicago Tribune, said was actually a break for the customers, as their endurance was pretty well strained by other discomforts of the occasion. Durocher was in the starting lineup at second base because Lazzari had torn a muscle when swinging at an outside pitch in an exhibition game a few days earlier. Koenig was back in the lineup at shortstop. In front of 20,000 shivering fans, by his words and actions, Durocher asserted himself. He was, in the words of Arthur Mann, entering the big leagues with a solid brass tongue, and his first target in the first inning of that opening day was Ty Cobb. At the beginning of his 24th and final year in the majors and playing this season for the Athletics. According to Frank Graham of the New York Sun, that day he taunted Cobb to the verge of distraction. The Yankees won 8-3 in a game that lasted for almost 2.5 hours at a time when the average 9-inning game lasted 1 hour and 55 minutes. Durocher drove in 2 runs in the 3rd inning with a long single down the right field line. But far more notable was what had or had not transpired between Leo and Cobb on the base paths. The question, still debated today, was whether Durocher had used his hip to impede Cobb's progress from first to third, throwing him off stride so Cobb was thrown out at third. Passing Durocher on his way back to his post in the outfield, Cobb snarled at him, "The next time you try that, I'll cut your legs off, you fresh busher." This was first recounted in Babe Ruth's own book of baseball, ghostwritten by sports writer and later commissioner of baseball Ford Frick, and published later that same year. The story was later repeated by syndicated columnist Grantland Rice, then again with minor variation in many articles and at least a dozen books. The hip story had such strong legs attached to it that Chicago Tribune columnist Dave Condon retold it verbatim and in print on several occasions in the 1970s. Even veteran announcer Red Barber recalled the hip when he talked about Durocher. Cobb long denied the incident and explained in his 1961 autobiography, "Leo gets all kinds of credit for having slyly slammed a hip into me and put me flat on my face. He never saw the day he could do it. In 1928, when this play supposedly happened, I knew a few too many tricks to be caught by some skinny infielder's hip. What makes the lie all the more obvious is that the story has me out on the play. Had Durocher clipped me, I'd have been entitled to the next base on interference." Durocher himself never claimed the hip story was true. Later in the 1928 season, in an interview with Harold Burr of the Brooklyn Eagle, Durocher himself retold the story in his own words, asserting only that they had exchanged words and that Cobb threatened to cut him if he didn't stay out of his way when he was running the base path. "Many stories have been written about the fight I had with Ty Cobb the first time I ever played against him, and I always read them with great interest because no fight ever took place," he wrote many years later. "What happened was that Cobb was on first base, and Tris Speaker, who was also finishing out his career in Philadelphia, hit a line drive through the pitcher's box. I dove for the ball, got my glove on it, and slowed it down enough so that it stopped in short center field just off the dirt. While I was scrambling after it, I happened to get in Cobb's way, accidentally, of course, forcing him to pull up just enough so that I was able to throw him out at third to end the inning." As Durocher was passing Cobb on the way to the visitor's dugout, Cobb said, "You get in my way again, you fresh busher, and I'll step on your face." Leo then recalled,
I hadn't said a word to Cobb, and I still didn't. Hell, this is Ty Cobb. But Ruth, who was coming in from left field, wanted to know what Cobb had said. "Well, kid," Ruth said. He called everybody kid. "The next time he comes to bat, call him a penny pincher." I'd never heard that word before, but just from the way everybody on the bench started to laugh, I had a pretty good idea what it meant. What I didn't know was that Cobb had a reputation for being a very tight man with a dollar, and had been ready to fight at the drop of a penny pincher for years. Well, naturally, I can't wait for him to get up again so I can go to work on him. And holy cow, he turns in the batter's box, pointing his finger, and the umpire has to restrain him. Now the game is over, and the umpires don't have a care anymore. Both clubs have to use the third base dugout to get to the locker room, and Cobb races over to cut me off. He's out to kill me, and I'm looking for a place to run because I'm not about to tangle with Mr. Cobb. Finally, Babe came running in and put his arm around Cobb, and he's kind of grinning at him and settling him down. Now, what are you going to do? You don't want to hit the kid, do you? And while Babe has his attention, boom, I'm up the stairs like a halfback and into the locker room. Whatever else was true or false about that first game, Durocher knew he was going to pay for riding Cobb and other opponents without mercy, and before he was out of uniform that day, he proclaimed, "Watch tomorrow's first pitch, and watch me when it comes up there," pointing to his head. There was no pitch on the next day because of a postponed game, but on the following day, Durocher got up to bat and waited for that pitch. The throw came from the left arm of Ossie Orwall, and it carried enough power to have torn Leo's head off, reported Arthur Mann. But Leo was scrabbling unharmed in the dirt, and the count was 1-1. Leo arose, brushed himself off, and turned to Orwall with 3 fingers upraised. 3 more of them, pal, he called in a rasping voice, and I'll be on first base where I belong. Leo dove out of the way of 3 more balls aimed at his head and took first base. The Yankees won the game 1-0, and Leo bragged about his ability as a beanball dodger. With rare confidence, Durocher predicted that Orwall, who did not finish the game, would soon be gone from the major leagues, and he would not. As the season progressed, Durocher antagonized Cobb as well as other major opponents. By the end of May, after the Yankees had played every team in the league, Frank Graham wrote of Durocher in the New York Sun, "His days on the bench are spent annoying the opposing players on their appearance, their work, and occasionally their antecedents." Durocher relished his new role, bragging that he was having a lot of fun riding the big fellows, especially Cobb, who he tried to put in the role of aggressor. "Anytime the great Ty pulls a crack, he's going to get one right back." "Why don't you give yourself up?" he called to Cobb one day. "What are you waiting for them to do? Cut your uniform off and burn it?" Cobb snarled threats at him, and he laughed. "Go home, Grandpa," he said. "Get wise to yourself. If you keep on playing with us young fellows, you might get hurt." Leo's big league debut had begun well. In his first 4 games, he had 6 hits and drove in 5 runs, all batting as a right-hander. He hit safely in his first 7 games for a while, subbing at second for the injured Tony Lazzari. After Lazzari had returned, he replaced the underperforming Mark Koenig at shortstop and continued to hit for almost 4 weeks. At the end of 37 games, his average was .312, and a few of the hits had been important ones, such as the game-winning triple with the bases loaded on May 29th against the Washington Senators. In the field, his early reviews were great. "That circus stuff he has been doing with the New York team is everyday baseball with him," said Hank Gowdy, former player and now managing in the International League. "I've seen some fielders in my time, but that kid's a wonder." During these early weeks in pinstripes, the Yankee rookie created a name for himself off the field as well. Leo Durocher, Yankee infielder, is the only big leaguer with enough nerve to wear spats and carry a cane, was one report that became national news, thanks to the Associated Press.
In early June, during batting practice at Comiskey Park, as Durocher stepped into the batting cage, White Sox commentary could be heard from the dugout. Buck Krause.
Did you see that piece in the paper about this guy wearing spats and carrying a cane around New York?
Mo Berg.
No.
Krause.
On the level.
Bill Hunnefield.
I've seen him wearing spats.
Krause shouts.
Hey, spats, where's your cane?
Hunnefield shouts.
Take your cane up to the plate. Maybe you can hit with that.
Durocher had landed in Manhattan in the midst of Prohibition. He lived at the Piccadilly Hotel at 227 West 45th Street in the heart of the theater district just off Broadway, which was awash in illegal booze and the speakeasies, clip joints, and blind pigs where it was served. They called the district the White Light District, and it stretched from 14th to 59th Streets along Broadway and two to three avenues on either side. Texas Guinan, Manhattan's most famous speakeasy hostess, managed more than half a dozen joints herself in or near the district, including the 300 Club, the Texas Guinan Club, the Century Club, Salon Royale, Club Intime, El Fay, and the Club Argonaut. One of Guinan's entertainers was a dancer and would-be actor named George Raft, who hailed from the west of Broadway rough-and-tumble neighborhood known then and now as Hell's Kitchen. Raft made his gangster acquaintances in the clubs, of which he said,
"If you were an entertainer on Broadway during those days, you would have to be blind and lame not to associate with gangsters. Look, they owned the clubs."
Raft and Durocher first met in a pool room on 48th Street and liked each other instantly. A former bat boy and mascot for the New York Highlanders before they became known as the Yankees, Raft was naturally drawn to the young ball player, who seemed every bit as brash as he was. Durocher hit the nightclubs with regularity, often beginning the night with a show at the Winter Garden Theater in Midtown and then racing up to Harlem to catch the late show at the Cotton Club to see Bill Robinson or Cab Calloway. This was the New York of Damon Runyon, and Durocher played it like a character from the second act of Guys and Dolls.
"Three people could stand out in the rain under his hat brim when he first hit the big town," wrote columnist Jim Murray. "The pinstripes could be seen in the dark, the shoes came in two or more colors, and the shoulders were wide enough for condors to light on."
It required no time at all for Durocher to attract a coterie of limelight followers in New York, wrote Arthur Mann. Traveling with the Yankees during the late 1920s, Mann became fascinated with Durocher and
made a close study of him,
getting as close to him as any journalist ever would.
"The Yankee uniform was a pass to everywhere," Mann observed. "Even his cacophony of words took on importance to listeners. He was a pushover for flattery and a flashy wardrobe, though his rookie salary was scarcely enough to clothe him in overalls. Wear now and forget the cost. You're a champion. Dress like one. Always travel first class. Meet big people. And it was in Prohibition days when you never asked your friend how he made his money for fear he would tell you."
Durocher spent heavily. When one of his brothers became ill in early May, the Yankees gave him a day off and he motored to West Springfield and back in a brand new car. Before he left Springfield, he dropped in on a smoker at the Merrick Athletic Club, where he auctioned off a bat and glove he had autographed. His early success moved his newfound friends to organize Leo Durocher Day on June 23, 1928 at Yankee Stadium. A four-page brochure was printed to introduce their pride and joy as the regular Yankee rookie. You all know Leo by now, for he has taken New York baseball fans by storm with his fiery personality and regular fellow spirit. Proclaimed by critics to be the freshest and gamest rookie ever to make a big league debut, a future big league star, and a credit to baseball. The brochure was printed and first distributed on a day when Durocher had played only 10 games in Yankee Stadium. The sponsors for the big day included names that lifted eyebrows even during the lawless days of Prohibition. Tommy Holmes of the Brooklyn Eagle later recalled, the list was studded with the nightlight characters of Broadway and the Roadhouse circuit, many of whom, sooner or later, were tangled up in the law. The most recognizable name on the list was Conrad Connie Immerman, bootlegger and legendary operator of Connie's Inn, a nightclub at 131st Street and 7th Avenue in Harlem, which had first featured the likes of Louis Armstrong, Fats Waller, and Fletcher Henderson. As the big day approached, both the team and Durocher went into a slump in the West, which is what the Midwestern teams were referred to before expansion to the West Coast. The Yankees lost 6 out of 7, and Durocher was benched a week before his special day. On the morning of Leo Durocher Day, more than 400 people from Western Massachusetts boarded a special train for the event, along with a drum and bugle corps from Our Lady of Hope Church. Durocher's parents traveled to the Bronx by car. Another contingent came by train from Hartford. After the first game of that day's doubleheader, which the Yankees lost, Durocher was honored in an infield ceremony during which he was presented with 2 traveling bags and $1,500, a check for $500, and a traveling bag from the Springfield Chamber of Commerce, and a traveling bag, and a crisp $1,000 bill from his friends. Because of the amount of cash involved, the bill was presented by Detective Dennis Dinny Mahoney, who headed the Detective Association of the New York Police Department and had also been one of the day's sponsors. The Yankees went on to lose the second game to the Red Sox before only 15,000 fans. As Harrison of the Times puts it, "The only drawback to Durocher Day is that Durocher didn't play in either game." The awkwardness of Leo sitting out the games was compounded when the local contingent, sitting behind the Yankee dugout in a special VIP section, realized that they would not see Leo in action and began cheering for the Red Sox. If Durocher had been humbled by sitting out his day on the bench or embarrassed by the behavior of hometown friends, he didn't show it. There is no record of what the other Yankees thought of a substitute player having a special day, but it could not have been favorable. Wade Hoyt, who lost the first of those 2 Durocher Day games and got to watch his 8-game winning streak come to an end, did not get his day until 1965, and that was at Crosley Field in Cincinnati when he retired as a Reds broadcaster. Gehrig's came in 1939 when he delivered his Luckiest Man Alive oration, and Babe Ruth finally got his day at Yankee Stadium in 1947 when he was riddled with cancer and near death. After the doubleheader, Durocher and his Broadway friends headed for Pelham in Westchester County to hear Vincent Lopez's orchestra play dance tunes at Joe Panny's Wood Manston Inn. The nightclub was a favorite for revelers from New York City carrying their own silver flasks of bootleg.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.